I did it my way.
Hey, hey, welcome to Half the Battle.
Larry Hama, without a doubt the father of G.I. Joe, a real American hero. He wrote the file cards and the comics. And considering he and Marvel basically invented Cobra in general and the Baroness specifically, it's fair to say Hasbro gave him quite a lot of freedom in his work, which was a smart thing to do.
But of course, he wasn't completely free.
He was still a hired gun for Hasbro, and so had to include all new toys they presented him.
Well, almost all.
This didn't always sit well with him, and from time to time, he'd let his displeasure be known in certain subtle, or sometimes not so subtle, ways. So today, we're taking a look at six such examples, where Larry Hama used his position as the comics writer to dunk on Hasbro. Number 6. Look in the comic issues to see who isn't there.
Now, I did say Marvel had to include almost all new toys.
That's because there were exceptions when Larry put his foot down, so you'll find a few characters and vehicles missing from the comic. Like, for instance, Crystal Ball, who did appear in one Special Missions issue, but that wasn't written by Hama, so we can ignore that, please and thank you. Then there's Cobra Law, and the Mega Marines, and Cobra Law, and the Mega Monsters.
And did I mention Cobra Law?
Yeah, there were some things Larry felt just wouldn't work in the comic, and he had enough pull to keep them out.
Some things, however, were inevitable because of how important they were.
Which leads us to number 5, a partial absence of Duke and others. For most of Hasbro's early marketing, Duke was their golden boy. He was the leader of the Joes in the first season of the cartoon, was plastered all over the place as the G.I. Joe icon, and always got the girl.
And Larry didn't care for him much.
Or at least he didn't care for the way the character was presented. To him, a first sergeant is supposed to be tough as nails, runs the company, but isn't the commanding officer. So he didn't really know what to do with him, which meant Duke got a lot less screen time in the comic. And he didn't get the girl. Snake Eyes did. And while the relationship between Scarlet and the ninja happened naturally, it's accidentally a nice dunk on the cartoon where she was with Duke.
There was another character that got much less screen time in the comics.
Namely, Sergeant Slaughter, who showed up in just a few issues, but I went over all of that in May. So it didn't matter how much Hasbro loved a Joe or Cobra, if Larry didn't like him, they didn't get to be stars. Number 4. A comedic death. Death in the comic was handled with gravitas, especially when it came to named characters. Now, Hasbro wasn't very keen on having their creations bite the dust.
Since, you know, they had toys to sell.
But they did, on occasion, allow some of them to be killed if they didn't have plans to make any more figures of them. And there were, of course, people like Dr. Venom and Quinn who were created specifically for the comic, so Hasbro didn't care if they got killed, so we saw quite a bit of death. And it was handled well every time. It was never glamorous, it always reminded you war was hell and was taken very seriously.
Most of the time.
There was an exception, namely Darklon. In issue 146, Cobra Commander says he'll be a huge threat and difficult to deal with. But Destro pushes one button and launches a missile at him. His last words are, "I'm so mad I could explode." And then he does.
Ha! Ha! Ha!
Yeah, this death had all the gravitas of a Looney Tunes cartoon.
Yeah, I think Larry didn't much care for this guy.
Hard to imagine why, he just looks so cool. So he gave him the send-off he thought he deserved. Number 3. Transformers are just toys. In January of 1987, Marvel, under direction of Hasbro, had a major crossover miniseries called G.I. Joe and the Transformers. Four issues pitted G.I. Joe, Cobra, the Autobots and the Decepticons against each other. This miniseries was not written by Larry Hama, and he considered it non-canon with the main G.I. Joe comic.
In fact, he considered it so much non-canon that he wanted to subtly address it.
And so he did, at the end of 1987, in issue 5 of Special Missions, where Slipstream presented one of his crew with a Transformers toy to give to his kid. Doing this, he gave a hint that Transformers were just a toy line in the G.I. Joe universe, and not a race of sentient robots. Of course, this little act of rebellion got undone later when Transformers Generation 2 showed up in the main G.I. Joe series, but the dig at Hasbro was there. Number 2. Eco-Warriors sure are ugly.
Our last two entries are basically Larry breaking the fourth wall and addressing the reader directly through one of the characters.
This entry concerns the debut of the Eco-Warriors in issue 123. Flint, who's going to be their leader, meets them and says this: "I can also infer from the garish use of your outfits that this is not a covert operation." With the reply being that he doesn't get to be leader without a garish suit of his own, remarking they're made from recycled action figures. Now that's a double dunk right there.
Or maybe even a triple dunk.
First, there's the acknowledgement that these are ugly, ugly figures. Then there's the fact the suits are made out of action figures, which I interpret as a way of saying, yeah, you're trying to give an environmental message through the use of plastic, non-degradable action figures. Bit hypocritical, isn't it? It could also be a dig at Hasbro constantly reusing action figure molds and recoloring them, something that would happen to the Eco Warriors figures later down the line.
And now, the final, and for me, the best instance of Larry Hama dunking on Hasbro is...
Number 1. Cobra Commander's opinions on Raptor. Issue 59, when Cobra Commander met Raptor.
They didn't hit it off.
The very first moment he lays eyes on him, the Commander, not unreasonably, asks why this guy is dressed like a bird, assuming he's a nutcase, and wonders why he isn't in a straitjacket.
You don't see Hama talking through the Commander until he directly confronts Raptor, though.
This bird brain is crazier than Dr. Mindbender! I'm sick and tired of wackos in funny suits! What do you sleep in? A nest?
If this isn't Larry showing some playful disgust with the action figures, I don't know what is. And nice that he brings up the noted shirt hater Dr. Mindbender.
Larry would have made a great YouTube reviewer!
And it just goes to show, if you're a good creator, you can get away with taking potshots at your boss. So, that was the list.
If you can think of any more times Larry dunked on Hasbro, do let me know in the comments below. Well, I'll see you next time, everybody. And hey, why not like, share, and subscribe if that's your thing?
I did it my way.
But your bollocks did up good, you did.
If you can think of any more times Larry dunked on Hasbro, do let me know in the comics below. In the comics below, I knew I was gonna say that.